What's up, guys? It's John and Cody here, and today we're going to be talking about HGA. Now, HGA has been around for about a year now. You know, they're a relatively new company, but they are known mostly for their custom labels, and they have lots of different designs. A lot of them are pretty cool. Some of them are hit and miss, but anyways, we are going to be focusing this video on some of the inconsistencies that we have noticed from our submissions. Now, we have submitted roughly 100 cards in total. 60 were probably, we kind of did it in two phases. So the first 60 were mostly 1990s and early 2000s basketball and football cards. Out of those 60 cards we submitted, we had zero Jim Mint cards. So we were 0 for 60.
Yeah. Or HGA. You guys probably did not like that.
And we were getting them back and we're like, what are we doing wrong?
Yeah.
But then after we got all those cards back, we submitted another 40 modern cards. So mostly cards within the last 5 years, so 2016 through now, basically.
I think that's fair, yeah.
And out of those 40 cards, about 50% of them came back Jim Mint, which is just ridiculous. So it kind of like makes us wonder, like, what is the difference between the cards we sent then and now? And obviously there's two big things that you that are in question. Is it, does HGA grade modern cards easier than the old cards, and it does it have anything to do with the AI? Does it I know a lot of the newer cards are shiny, have a different sheen on them. Maybe it likes it and makes it look, the surface look more complete than the dull paper cards that you'll have from the 90s or older. Is that something? I don't know. Or maybe HGA is just getting more lenient in general as time has gone on, you know? So I mean, any of those are possible. I mean, maybe
both could be possible.
I mean, maybe I mean, even now it's hybrid grading company. It goes through AI and then it is looked at by a person. Is that person actually looking at it afterwards, or are they just trusting that the AI is correct? I don't know. But we are going to focus on a couple of examples here that we have and look at the subgrades and maybe raise some questions about the quality of HGA. I don't know. We'll let you decide, but we're going to start with centering, and Cody is going to show us the card we have here.
All right, so one of our most recent submissions contained this bad boy, J.K. Dobbins, who's on IR. However, the centering on this card got an 8.0. Now, if you look at this card, you can obviously tell that the right to left is heavy. This side of the border is thicker than the left. Also, the top to bottom. Top side is heavier than the bottom. So, an 8 on the front. I'd say that's pretty fair.
Mm-hmm.
Even when you turn this over, a little left to right heavy, top to bottom is definitely heavy. So we agree.
Yep.
An 8 on the subgrade for centering for this specific card is justified. Again, this was our most recent return.
And I think that it would line up with the other grading companies as well. I think that they would also give an 8 if they gave out subgrades for that card.
So this one is one of our earlier cards. As John mentioned, we sent 60 cards from 1990 to 2000. We all agreed that this was a 10. We thought this was a perfect card all around. But focusing on centering, if you look at her hair and her shoe, looks pretty even. And then the top, or I'm sorry, left to right, looks pretty centered as well. However, when you do turn the card over, the left to right looks a little, the left side looks a little heavy and the bottom looks a little heavy from the top side. So HGA has made it known that the back of the card is just as important as the front. And this centering got a 9. Okay. So again, an older card, a card we sent off in the beginning of our experience with HGA, got a 9 in the centering. And then we get the another card.
And is that justified a 9? I don't know. We had it coming back as a 10. So maybe it should have gotten a 9.5. I guess there's, you know, it's possible that 9 could be justified here as well. But this one stumped me.
Yeah, I would say that this one should have been 9.5. Just because the centering is bad on the back. So I don't think it should count as much. But that's just me. This one, on the other hand, is one of our most recent submissions. And the centering got 9.5. Now you can look at this for a second before we tell you. Comment below, what do you think is wrong with this card? All right, now that you did that, now look at this. Left to right is heavy. And then John would like to say that the top and the bottom are even a little off.
I would say if you look at where his helmet is and how close it is to the top of the card, and then look right below the RC and how much space you have there below the card, I'd say that it's bottom heavy. as well as left heavy.
So let's flip this card over. Left to right seems pretty good, but the top to bottom, it looks like the top is way thinner than the bottom.
Yeah,
so absolutely. Considering that the front and the back of the card carry the same weight, the centering on this got a 9.5. Now, I'm going to pull out a card that's easy to identify, the borders, as opposed to that Becky Hammon. This centering got 8, and the DeAndre Hopkins got 9.5. Although I'm emotionally attached to the DeAndre Hopkins, I believe that the DeAndre Hopkins should be in line with an 8.5.
Yeah.
Maybe even an 8.
Yeah, and I told Cody, man, I am ecstatic about that grade you got on that D Hopkins card, but how did it get a 9.5 for centering?
Right.
That just doesn't make sense to me. That's crazy.
All right, let's switch gears. What's the second subgrade you want to look at?
Yeah, so the second subgrade we're going to be looking at is surface. So I know we kind of talked about surface a little bit. Some of those older cards are going to be a little dull surface finish. It's not going to have as much shine or sheen. And I don't know if it maybe makes it easier for the AI to, on the dull cards, pick up the scratches or maybe any of the imperfections because it's not reflecting light back at you.
Yeah.
But we definitely missed something on this card right here that we're going to
see. We didn't miss anything because Cody pre-graded this card and I knew that there was a surface issue. But I wanted to see how critical HGA is with surface pitting.
Absolutely.
And I gave you a hint already. So let's look right at it. So if we get that shine, you can tell under Tom Brady's elbow right here, there's a pit and then a whole cluster.
And first off, what did it get for surface?
Oh, I'm sorry. The surface got a 9.
A 9.
And it has all these pittings in it. So that is not, we don't.
So I looked at this card, I counted 13 different pits on this card, which is crazy because my Becky Hammon card right here,
yeah,
clean surface, no scratches, no denting, nothing, front, yeah, and back, got a 9 as well, the exact same grade that this card got.
Yeah, that we don't agree with this. I pre-graded this card an 8 and I didn't know how surface pitting was going to work with them, but it got a 9 on the surface. The overall grade got a 9.
Yeah, so the crazy part is the centering got an 8.5 on this.
Yeah.
And I think the centering is better than the Hopkins card, personally.
It's a little heavy left to right, but I think it's a little bit better.
It's heavy left to right, but it got an 8.5 as opposed to a 9.5. So,
all right.
Anyways.
Well, let's you guys look at it.
Obviously, I mean, there's some discrepancies with the surface, whether it's an old card, new card. I don't know, but I feel like anybody who was looking at this card under a lamp would see that immediately.
We just did.
How did they not see that after it went? Well, first off, how did the AI miss it?
Right.
But then after that, how did the person who's looking at the card miss it?
So that is the way they do it, right? They use the AI to scan the card, and then someone reviews the card to see if the AI was too critical or not critical enough.
All right, and so the last thing, that's the first two things. The last thing we're going to look at is the labels. Now, this is their bread and butter. This is what they're known for right here, the custom labels.
Yeah.
And sometimes the labels just look spectacular, but other times it just leaves you scratching your head. Like, how did they come up with these color schemes?
Yeah.
And so we'll show you an example of an inconsistency that we found.
So let's pull the Tom Brady back up.
Yeah, there he is.
So Tom Brady, club level, silver prism. This is a neutral match card.
Correct.
That's the label choice here. All right? In a separate order, so this is, let's say, order A. In order B,
which
I sent this.
We're within like a week apart, right?
Yeah, they literally delivered the next day. Order B delivered the next day. Same exact Tom Brady card. Same exact label choice, drastically different.
Both neutral match card.
Both neutral match card. And as a collector, if I got this card in first,
mm-hmm,
and I said, dang, I really love that label, let me send in another one, same exact label choice, I want to get this one back. But nope, I got this one. I would be mad.
I would be pissed.
I would be mad. So from an order processing standpoint, HGA, listen, when you get a card for the first time and it's neutral match card, that should be consistent every single time after that. The first label should be custom, quote unquote, and then every single one after that should be the same, in my personal opinion.
I agree, and we kind of talked about this beforehand. The other way you could do it is, if it is a custom label, when you do neutral match card, you could have another box for which color you want to match on the card and at least give the person who's buying the card the opportunity to pick which which color they're matching to.
Yeah.
So if you wanted it to be red for Tampa, you say red, okay, it's going to be red. At least you know what you're getting, right? It's not going to be random every time.
Yeah. So let's take it a step further.
Yep.
This is a true custom label. Let's bring the DeAndre Hopkins back up. Now, I will just be the first one to tell, I had no idea what they were going to pull on this custom, but I was hoping they could bring some, you know, attention or just, I don't know, attractiveness to this card because it's really dull. So there's clouds in the back, but the label itself.
It's great.
What is that? It's like a geometric explosion back there with a hint of the Houston.
So not only did Cody pay an extra $10.
Yep.
To get this card with a custom label. He also had to wait like an extra week for them to make the custom label.
Correct. Yep.
And then it came back looking like a gray blob.
Yeah, that was, I'm not impressed by this one. And HGA has made it public that they are looking at their designers to make sure that they are giving the hobby the best custom labels possible. Now, that one was bad. However, yeah, this
with that
one
being said,
is freaking sweet.
Yeah.
So it is the infamous Panini Select Zebra print, and they killed it with this one. This is a custom label, $10 extra, and it looks fantastic. This complements the card, in my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, it like we've been saying, it is kind of hit or miss whether you're going to get a label that you really like or a label that you just kind of look at it and you're scratching your head like, how did they come up with this color scheme?
Yeah.
And so that's kind of some of the risk that you're going to run with HGA. Sometimes you'll be really happy with it. Sometimes you're not going to be so happy. But, you know, as far as the variability goes, are you better off going with a PSA, a Beckett, someone you know what their label is going to look like and it might not distract from the appeal of the card?
Yep.
Or do you want to risk it and maybe come up with something that completely complements the card and makes it look spectacular?
Yeah. I don't know. I think at this point, after 100 cards, personally, I get PSA's labels now. Like, I get why they're just so plain.
Yeah. It doesn't distract from the card, and you know what you're going to get.
Right, yeah.
So, I mean, there's pros and cons to both. But anyways, guys, hopefully you enjoyed this video. We have left you with a lot to think about. If you have any comments on, you know, whatever we've covered here, go ahead and leave a comment below and like and subscribe our channel. That really helps us out a lot. If you have any ideas for future videos, let us know.
And we just want to say, I apologize for cutting you off, but we have had a pleasant experience with HGA. They have met their quota lead times. I do want to say that it's important from a customer standpoint. You pay for 60 days, you get 60 days. Granted, this one was a little bit
plus
late.
Or minus. I mean,
it was a week. It was a week late. But overall experience with HGA, would you agree, has been positive?
I would say that it has been positive, and that kind of takes out the resale value. You know, that's
for
another discussion.
Problem. Yeah.
But I would say their customer service has been above average compared to some of the other companies, and then for the most part they do a good job.
Yeah, so I just want to say that we're not dogging them. We're
too
just
much.
Looking at what they've been providing us, and we just have some questions.
Yeah,
so
absolutely. Well, anyways, guys, it's been fun, and we will see you guys on the next one.